is there something that Moshe Rabbeinu did have that Mashiach won't have? I mean, if Mashiach is an actualization of Moshe, as you say, it sounds like Moshe is a prototype and it's perfected with Mashiach. But could we say the opposite?
I don't think that that's true.
Right, from what you're saying, it sounds like that's not true.
I don't think it's true. I think there are certain aspects of comparison. Like the Rambam says Mashiach will be intellectually greater than Shlomo, okay, who's the wisest man. So he says point blank that Mashiach will be greater. And he says that in terms of prophecy, where the Rambam says that Moshe was the greatest prophet, he says that the Mashiach will be close to Moshe.
But not quite.
But that's
kind of shorthand for saying he's not going to be able to undo the Torah, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Because if his prophecy was greater, he'd be able to rewrite things.
Well, that would be part of it.
That's one of the principles.
Right, that's right. Right.
Although I don't think it's just tied to the prophecy. It's a question of how that prophecy is related to the people. The major statement of the Rambam of why Moshe Rabbeinu's prophecy can't be challenged, if you read in terms of Hilchus Yesodei HaTorah, where he actually states it, it's not because Moshe was the greatest prophet. It was because Moshe's prophecy was experienced by the people. In other words, it wasn't him coming down and saying, I'm the greatest prophet, listen to me. Okay, we buy you're the greatest prophet. It was because the people experienced Moshe's level. Right. And the Rambam is adamant that unless the people have a similar type of experience, and he says it's not going to happen. So the major argument of Judaism in terms of why revelation is accepted is because there never was a parallel. It's not
Messianic times will not have, although revelation I assume will be happening then as well, or something akin to revelation, it will still not compare to what happened at Sinai.
The Rambam speaks about the, very interesting, he throws something very interesting into the laws of the Mashiach, where he talks about, and even in the day, and in the days of the Mashiach, Moses will add three more cities to the cities of refuge. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it's not even talked about really in the Torah. So there is an aspect of revelation, as it were. There's an uncovering, some kind of revealing of something else, some other dimension.
Well,
but
that's his proof. That's one of his Torah proofs for why Mashiach is still coming, isn't it?
We had the
three on the western side of the Jordan, but we never had him on the other side, and therefore to fulfill Torah. That the Torah would not give us a useless mitzvah, right? Why would the Torah say build three on the other side if we never did it, right?
Right, but the fact is, Rome himself says we really don't know what will happen at the time of Mashiach.
I want to just point out another point. We can't really compare Moshe and Mashiach per se, because it's stacked unfairly. We don't know who Mashiach is.
Right. Right.
We're not really comparing. We're comparing apples and oranges. We're comparing a personality with a job description.
Right.
So
right.
To be fair, we have to look at, you know,
at the job description.
Reduce
Moses down to
right.
to the his job description.
Right. Is his job description a prefiguration?
Right.
Well, of course it is, and so is everybody's job in this world is a prefiguration
of Moses.
Well, in certain sense,
because
every positive contribution that all of humanity, every human being in this world brings into the world contributes to the coming of Mashiach.
Everything is needed. You see, this is an interesting perspective in the sense that what you're really raising is, I think, is a certain level, what exactly is the task of Mashiach?
Yeah.
In the sense that, in a certain way, it's like an army, or it's like a baseball team or something like that, you know, or a football team or whatever. You could have the best wide receiver and, you know, thing, but if you don't have a quarterback throwing the ball, it's not going to do anything. But on the other hand, if you're going to have a championship team, you need the wide receiver, you need the quarterback, and he said. So the point is what's the Mashiach? Is Mashiach the quarterback? Is he the coach or whatever? But in a certain way, everyone has to participate. What I think you're asking is, what is the task? I think Moshe Rabbeinu had a unique task in certain ways, and the Ramban talks about this, in the sense that Moshe Rabbeinu also was a savior in certain ways. He redeemed the Jewish people out of Egypt. So the question emerges is, how do you compare Galus Mitzrayim, the Egyptian exile, to the present exile? And how do you compare the redemption there? And there is comparisons in the literature between the redemption of Egypt and the redemption from that will happen with the coming of Mashiach.
There are certain functions that are clear.
Right.
He unites the people. He does. Right. He takes the people from Egypt. He unites them around a central mission. He receives this Torah. There's a it brings in, okay, it inaugurates a new way of living, a new relationship with the Almighty. So in that sense, there's a beautiful parallel to obviously what Mashiach is doing.
Right. Yeah, it's an interesting thing the Ramban says. He says that, and it's based upon a Medrash, that at the end of the Egyptian experience, Pharaoh becomes a believer in the one God. It's a famous Medrash. And you see it also in the Ten Commandments. Forget the Medrash.
It's in Spielberg.
We're talking about the Ten Commandments. Who's 50?
Cecil B. DeMille.
Yeah, right. Yeah. You see when Yul Brynner falls back and he is God.
The fact Moses is God is God.
Yes. The fact is
great line. Right? Yeah.
Yeah. The fact is that so the Ramban says that Moshe only did it with one king. When the Mashiach comes, he'll do it throughout the world. In other words, everyone will recognize the one God.
But so then that's just a quantitative difference.
Yeah, no? but the question is that quantitative based upon a difference in personality, a difference in ability? I think what you said before is very true in the sense that Moshe was not a people person on a certain level.
How about David HaMelech then? Was Moshe is Mashiach more like David HaMelech than
But so was Moshe HaMelech.
He was actually a Melech.
Was Moshe HaMelech?
Do the classic managerial slice off pieces of his authority and give it to other people. He was everything. He was Melech.
Except that he didn't have to govern a state. You know, I mean, he governed the people, but they didn't really have an actual state.
But you know, the fact is that Moshe's task is it's also one of the great differences, and it's also going back to Kabbalistic thought in terms of understanding the physical realm and the physical world, in the sense that the perception of a Melech. First of all, the fact is that they say one of the aspects of Melech is that his whole personality is bound up to the people. So there's no inherent personal interest on a certain level. His interest is the people. But in addition to that, the Melech, it goes right down into the physical world. So if you read the stories of David HaMelech, he was right down. He was in the physical. He was a man who had love affairs and
Michael Jackson said, I'm a lover and a fighter. Well, he was both a lover and a fighter.
I don't want to.
And a writer and a singer.
I think we have to be careful in using.
David HaMelech was like Michael Jackson. Nobody should think that.
Yes, because you'd have two people about to attack you, right?
In Jewish law, he says, I don't know if we can say this on your show, but they say my hands are. His hands, he said, his hands were dirty with blood, right? The blood of marital harmony, okay? Yeah, right.
And I'm glad you didn't say it on the show. It's good.
It
reflects.
But the point is how physical he was, and also if you look if you learn through Shmuel, Book of Samuel.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, you see that he was loved by the people. They kept on cheering him on.